I wanted to ask you to talk a little bit about Ukraine, where we are right now, and something that I think everybody here would appreciate is the chance to hear you talk about this through the prism of your knowledge of Vladimir Putin. You spent a lot of time with him, a lot of time grappling with him. Spend a couple of minutes, if you can, explaining where we are and where you think this is headed.
Well, it is a tragedy of historic proportions. That's not news to people here. You can see it. I think that it is calling the question about a set of trends around the world that we've seen building for some time. Putin represented a very particular reaction to the ideals of democracy, but also globalization, the collision of cultures, the ability to harness anger and resentment around a ethno-nationalist mythology. And what we're seeing is the consequences of that kind of toxic mix in the hands of an autocratic government that doesn't have a lot of checks and balances. I think it is also fair to say that it is a bracing reminder for democracies that had gotten flabby and confused and feckless around the stakes of things that we tended to take for granted.
You include our democracy in that?
Yes, rule of law, freedom of press and conscience of the sort that, you know, one of your previous speakers, Mayor Maria Rasa, you know, represents, that you have to fight for that information, or you have to fight to provide people the information they need to be free and self-governing, that it doesn't just happen inevitably. Independent judiciaries, making elections work in ways that are fair and free. We have gotten complacent, and I think that I cannot guarantee that as a consequence of what's happened, we are shaking off that complacency. I will say that as somebody who grappled with the incursion into Crimea and the eastern portions of Ukraine, I have been encouraged by the European reaction, because in 2014, I often had to drag them kicking and screaming to respond in ways that we would have wanted to see from, you know, those of us who describe ourselves as Western democracies. In terms of Putin and where he takes this, there's been a lot of literature about this, a lot of reporting about this. I don't know that the person I knew is the same as the person who is now leading this charge. He was always ruthless. You witness what he did in Chechnya. He had no qualms about crushing those who he considered a threat. That's not new. For him to bet the farm in this way, I would not have necessarily predicted from him 5 years ago. How much of that is, you know, there have been speculation of the psychology of how much of that is him aging, him being isolated during COVID, et cetera. But as as much as I think we cannot count on sudden rationality from him, and as disquieting as the absolute control of information within Russia makes me doubtful about any kind of grassroots or oligarch resistance to the current course of events. I think that what has happened in Ukraine in many ways is more remarkable than, or less predictable than Putin wanting to seize territory.
You mean the high level of resistance?
The high level of resistance, the degree to which you have somebody like a Zelensky responding to the moment. Part of what changed between 2014 and today is that I think a sense of national identity continued to fortify itself. And ironically, him lopping off, at least informally annexing Crimea and portions on the east, I think clarified within Ukraine who they were and what they stood for. And I also think the thing that he did not fully anticipate is the degree to which the nature of war has changed, where everybody is seeing exactly what is happening on a real-time basis. And all those things, I think, may lead to, I won't say a happy resolution, but I think will has the potential of preventing a maximalist victory for Putin, and that over the long term may allow for a independent Ukraine.
Two more quick things on this. Do you think that Ukraine can win by your definition of what win might be?
I mean, you look at these cities and you look at the populations and you look at the exodus. It's hard to describe that as a win. And I think it's too early to tell what an end game looks like. I would not try to predict not only what's in the minds of Putin, but also how the Ukrainians conceive of this struggle, because we are sitting here comfortably and they are going through heck. And I, you know, the one thing I try not to do is to project onto them what they should do and what they should, what we should, how we should define what's tolerable, what the nature of their resistance should look like, how, if negotiations proceed, those should proceed. I think what we can do is support them and their efforts and their courage. And I think the other thing that we can do is take this as a lesson that sadly they're paying the price for, but that we still have, that speaks to a much more bumpy, difficult, violent, challenging future for the coming generation if we don't get some things right here at home, in Europe, and in Asia, in Latin America, because these are not, what's happening there is not isolated. What we're seeing is a reversion back to old ways of thinking about power and place and identity. And I think part of our complacency grew out of the notion that once the Berlin Wall fell and Mandela was released and the world was flat and you had McDonald's everywhere, and now suddenly that was it and we were done. And we forgot that that post-World War II 50-year stretch to 60-year stretch, that's the anomaly, right? And that there is millennia of brutality and pillage and violence and displacement and cruelty and we created a set of institutions out of 60 million people dying in World War II and tried to reconfigure, you know, how we might organize our societies, but it is not self-executing, right? It's something that we have to continually continually nurture and respond to new circumstances, whether that's changes in technology, changes in globalization, climate change. All those things require us to say, all right, what does that mean for our capacity to maintain human dignity and freedom and self-governance? And that's the prism through which we should be examining these questions and being willing to modify, adjust, reform our institutions to keep up with that. And that's something that I think we have not done as well as we need to.